This segment of WGCU's Local Untold Stories was underwritten by DeSoto County Public Schools.
The prairies of DeSoto County spread out for miles, open grasslands dotted by occasional stray pine trees and cabbage palms. There's not much standing to break the wind or shade one from the relentless Florida sun. In parts of this county, time seems to be standing still. The scenery looks much like it did over a century ago, when this was a wild, seemingly endless frontier. In 1887, when DeSoto County was established in South Central Florida, it covered a land area of nearly 4,000 square miles. Rural DeSoto's first county seat was the town of Pine Level. But within 2 years, the seat was moved to Arcadia, where it has remained ever since. During DeSoto County's early days, there were rugged, resilient folks, mainly ranchers, farmers, and cowboys, who lived on DeSoto's land, but they hadn't really tamed it. The vast prairies were often an unforgiving, lawless place where sheriff's deputies were spread thin, and their justice was swift.
Today, you steal. If the law catches you, they try you, right? Back then, they didn't. He killed you right there. There'd been a many one killed on that prairie and left right there. Sometime, if they had a shovel, they'd bury him. If not, he'd have stayed right there.
Early cowboys, or cow hunters, spent their weekdays working on the prairie. On the weekends, they rode into downtown Arcadia to blow off steam and spend their wages.
They come to town, they got a shave, bought a new pair of Levi's. Back in those days, you'd get a shave and a haircut at the barbershop and take a bath.
We had some killings, and we had some jailbreaks, and you had a lot of history, and because the old cowboys, they'd come to town and get drunk and try to tear everything up. But otherwise, it was really a subdued town.
In the 1880s, a discovery made in DeSoto led to a great rush for riches. Pebble phosphate, often referred to as Florida's black gold, was found in the Peace River. Phosphate was and still is used in roadbeds, fertilizers, and medicines. The industry boomed in the area, and speculators swooped in, looking to invest in phosphate-loaded land. Others arrived seeking work in the mines.
There must have been between 35 and 38 phosphate mines along the riverbed.
The primary Peace River Valley phosphate rush lasted around a decade and played an important role in DeSoto's development. By the early 1900s, most of the mines had moved further north, but some mines continued and still function today. With time, the rush on Florida's black gold and DeSoto County's wild frontier life faded. As roads were built, the region and its residents became less isolated, and by 1917, they found themselves facing far more than the demands of cattle and crops.
World War I brought on the first battle that was fought in the air. That was by aircraft. And Arcadia was one of the fortunate cities in the United States to have not only one, but two large airfields to train primary cadets for fighting the war in Europe.
Carlstrom and Door airfields were activated shortly after the U.S. entered the war, and both were located near Arcadia, which was soon named the Aviation City of Florida. The airfields became the military's primary southeastern training centers. Pilots found the area's open, grassy fields perfect for flying.
Because the land was so flat, and because the planes were so light and maneuverable, they didn't even have concrete runways. They ran off, took off, and landed on grass.
The establishment of the airfields augmented Arcadia's agriculture-based economy.
They hired mechanics, they had hired aviators. So it was a boon to the business, and Arcadia grew during those times.
Arcadia also benefited from the additional roads constructed to accommodate automobile traffic to and from the airfields. But when the war ended in 1918, Door Field was closed. Carlstrom Field continued operating as a flying school for a few years before it too was shut down. The closings affected Arcadia's economy, but the area continued to benefit from the new roads. Road system improvements that had begun during the war actually continued into the 20s, particularly with two major projects, the building of State Route 70 and US 17, two roads that intersect in Arcadia.
17 running north and south and 70 running east and west are the two main thoroughfares that brought more population, more industry, and more travel through our area.
These roadways were navigated regularly by members of America's first organized travel club, the Tin Can Tourists, named so for their dependence on canned foods that were travel friendly.
The first of the Tin Can Tourists began about 1921 when they began to come down in small trucks and makeshift roundabouts. Arcadia was where they had their annual Tin Can Tourist of the World conventions here, which lasted several weeks.
These early tourists were essentially a group of traveling campers who lived out of vehicles they'd rigged with folding side tents or converted truck beds. Members stayed in the Arcadia area for weeks at a time during the winter months.
Back then, not many people took vacations, and the ones that did probably came down for the health more than they did for the accommodations or the excitement here. It was mainly to get out of the north.
Tourists weren't the only ones benefiting from the newly built highways and state roads. Now, fresh produce and cattle could be transported out of the area by truck. This proved to be much quicker and more efficient than the earlier shipment of goods via train. But even with better modes of transportation, the county's huge landmass, 3,750 square miles, made conducting county business difficult.
People of the different sections of old DeSoto County complained about not having their own courthouse in their city.
Residents living near the county's outskirts in places like Punta Gorda resented having to travel all the way to Arcadia to take care of county business at the DeSoto courthouse. Many were in favor of dividing the county, which led to a heated political debate that lasted for many years.
In 1921, the state legislature divided Old DeSoto County into five present counties.
The new Charlotte, Hardy, Glades, and Highlands counties took up a large portion of the land, leaving DeSoto with only 630 square miles. Left within the new DeSoto County borders were communities like Arcadia, Pine Level, Fort Ogden, Nocatee, Owens, Brownville, Hull, and Joshua Creek. In 1929, businesses all over DeSoto began to suffer as the country slipped into the Great Depression.
business was almost came to a standstill. The inventories in their grocery stores even just, they would keep it down to a minimum, just enough to keep open.
Yet, the county's strong agricultural roots helped ease the Depression's effects on DeSoto residents.
In the country, the people lived off the land. We had cattle. If somebody had butchered beef, they didn't throw it out and get rid of it. They'd share it with neighbors.
I really didn't know there was a depression, and I did not know I was poor.
We didn't know any better. We were, we, if you had something to eat, well, you did well. Nobody went hungry.
DeSoto residents were a self-sufficient and industrious bunch. Time and again, they made the most out of what was available to them. Such was the case in 1929, when the American Legion Group in Arcadia needed funds to pay for their newly constructed building. While the Legion lacked funding, they did have an abundance of eager entertainers at their disposal, area cowboys and cowgirls. Hence, the Arcadia All-Florida Championship Rodeo was born. This exciting event was based on what cowboys and cowgirls did naturally on the prairie: rope, ride, and wrangle cattle.
Rodeo is probably the only sport that came about because of the what the cowboys have always done. Rodeo is competition between men and women, and the horses they ride, and the bulls they ride, and the calves they throw, and the calves they rope.
Today, the Arcadia All Championship Rodeo is one of the longest running rodeos in the United States. Residents proudly promote it as the granddaddy of them all. Over the years, the rodeo gave competitors a chance to display their particular skills for prizes and prestige.
They always had a prize. That first one was $10 prize. They might give away a hat, but they just enjoyed doing it. They enjoyed the competition. Now the cowboys can win thousands and thousands of dollars. They come from all over the country and from Canada to ride in this rodeo.
The rodeo is a nonprofit organization which distributes profits to local organizations. They do make profit, but it's all donated back into the communities.
Arcadia's rodeo continues to attract large crowds to its three regularly scheduled events each year. The first is in March, the second is on July 4th, and the third is in the fall.
It's a tradition that was just firmly entrenched in the people of Arcadia.
During the 1920s and 30s, people from nearby communities such as Fort Ogden, Nocatee, and Owens still came to Arcadia for their shopping and entertainment. Some also came for an education. Kids from all over the county were bused to DeSoto County High School in Arcadia.
I went to high school in the Depression. We were bused from Fort Ogden to Arcadia to school up here.
I graduated from DeSoto County High School in 1932. So I've been here ever since. There was 58 of them in our class who were graduated. But you knew everybody in school. You knew them by name.
While DeSoto residents came to Arcadia for most social activities, nearly all the surrounding communities had their own churches. Religion played an important role in the life of many folks. Singing in church choirs was an activity many enjoyed.
I remember singing the old hymns. My favorite is, I must tell Jesus all of my troubles. I cannot bear these burdens
alone. When I'm distressed, he kindly will help me.
Somehow, in between their social activities and full workloads, a surprising number of DeSoto residents also found the time to invent things, usually products intended to make life a little easier. It was during the early 30s that Arcadia City Councilman Lewis Bishop, an aspiring mechanic and engineer, invented a device meant to make his life easier, but it ended up starting a small revolution.
Lewis Bishop invented the rotary mower. The rotary mower succeeded the cylindrical mower that had its round thing that revolved over like this, and a lot of times it ran over the high grass and it didn't cut right down to the ground.
As city councilman, Bishop was responsible for seeing to it that Arcadia's grass was mowed in the city, in parks, and along roads, and he was delighted to discover his rotary mower cut better and faster than the old cylindrical type. Soon, other county, state, and federal governments were scrambling to buy Bishop's mowers.
It was a revolution in mowing. Necessity is a mother of invention. Well, that's what Lewis Bishop was.
While Bishop kept area grass from growing too tall, many other DeSoto residents were concerned with keeping their crops growing, especially citrus.
And I can remember being in the groves and watching them load the fruit. Also, the loading of the fruit was all done by hand in those days.
Market for fruit was fresh. You didn't have concentrate. So we had fresh fruit packing houses that packed oranges to send north.
They would bring the oranges in there from the orange grove, and they would go through a process of washing them, and they would be graded according to size and everything, and then they would be packed in boxes.
The boxed fruit were then shipped by rail and later by truck. The cattle industry was another agricultural force in DeSoto County. In 1938, the Arcadia Livestock Market opened. The new market provided a common place for people to buy and sell cattle.
It's been a lifesaver for the cattlemen because they have a ready market for hauling their cattle in, whereas they used to depend on the buyer coming to the ranch and buying cattle from the rancher.
Market auctions benefited both buyers and sellers. There was no haggling on prices or terms. Cattle simply went to the highest bidder. The first auction caused quite a stir across the county.
We were old cow people, old-timey people. We'd never seen an auction for cattle before, so everybody went out there to see what was going on. I skipped school and went out there, and it was pretty nice.
By the second auction, many area ranchers were eager to participate. They've been doing so ever since. While the market was making life a little easier for ranchers in the early 40s, things would soon get tougher for the county and the country. When America became involved in World War II, a large number of DeSoto County men were sent to fight overseas.
When the war started, it just about sucked up all the able-bodied men.
And it wasn't just the young men being called to serve.
Up to 36 or 38, even if they had families, they were drafted. So it was a full-time draft that took away all the healthy young men of America. We were attacked by Pearl Harbor December 7, 1941. After that, I was drafted.
In DeSoto County, as with the rest of the U.S., it was women, older men, and men deemed physically unfit who took to the task of running things on the home front. In Arcadia, that meant keeping up with regular workloads, plus supporting the extra business created from Carlstrom and Door airfields, which were reactivated around 1942.
I worked in the part where they kept the 25-hour records on every one of those airplanes because they had to have an inspection every 25 hours.
Because of their proximity to the active air bases, some Arcadians worried the area could become an enemy target. A few concerned residents took to their rooftops, where they watched the sky and listened for incoming aircraft.
You listened at the motor, and then you tried to see the light and the shape of the plane as it came over. I remember great big charts on the wall to help you identify that.
Like so many Americans, DeSoto citizens were worried about their loved ones fighting on other continents. People desperately craved news about what was happening abroad.
When I came back from World War II, I remember we used to watch television from the stores that had the television. They'd leave it on all night for people to go uptown and just watch it through the windows.
In 1945, the news Americans across the country had been waiting for finally came.
We were all called into the auditorium, and our principal, Harold Burke, was our principal, and he told us that the war was over and we could go home. So we went skipping down the road home.
DeSoto residents were happy to finally return to their daily lives and livelihoods. Local merchants were moving stock. Ranchers and farmers returned to the prairies and fields. And those inspired to invent went back to their creative endeavors. It was during the late 1940s that a number of new agriculture apparatus appeared in DeSoto County. Carl Fenton's Feeders was an important one. His device minimized the cost and effort involved in feeding cattle.
Fenton Feeder has been seen all over the state of Florida and many other states because it was kind of a revolution in feeding cattle out in the field, away from barns and where they were fed out in the pastures. And it rotated with the wind. The inside of it always was back to the wind.
Unlike common troughs, Fenton's design kept feed and salt safe from wind and rain. Before DeSoto residents Parker and Garner developed the cattle squeeze in 1946, ranchers or cowhands had to catch animals with a rope and manually hold them to the ground to treat for insect infestations and infections, or to brand or dehorn them. The cattle squeeze isolated the animal so it could be tended to easily.
One by one, they would take care of the cattle by moving a lever that would close the kettle in a squeeze.
When DeSoto's pine forests were logged in the 1800s, not much could be done with the remaining land because it was covered with tree stumps. It took another inventor to solve the problem. Lawrence Newton created the cabbage palm and tree stump remover.
These instruments would go in and just pull those stumps right out, load them on these big trucks.
Jessup's root plow was another machine designed for clearing land.
He has ground up whatever was left of the smaller pieces and of the rough terrain that leveled the land for irrigation or for cultivation. The land then became beautiful and expensive, just that simple. From the inventions that were invented here in Arcadia, out of necessity.
Driving through DeSoto County in Florida, one can easily imagine and long for a time gone by. DeSoto's heritage includes a long line of courageous pioneers, hardworking men and women who loved and honored the land, and who for hundreds of years planted the crops and raised the cattle that filled the plates of people throughout Florida. It's to the land and the people of DeSoto County that this program is dedicated.
There's a fight going on all the time to change that. It's to make Arcadia like Braden and Sarasota and on the East Coast, but somebody's got to raise the crop, and it takes a lot of land to grow food.
They have to love their work. There's no reward for it. You don't get a pension when you retire. Just like a farmer, he has nothing really but his farm work to do every day. He's really got to love it to stay there and do it every day.
I feel very honored for the lifespan that I've had in that I got a chance to watch, I guess what I would call the changing of America as such. I got to watch people that worked hard, but yet were people of integrity. And I think that's, it struck me most of all. They were people of their word.
To order a video of this program, call 1-888-824-0030 or visit our website at wgcu.org, and please refer to the program number on your screen. This program was produced for the citizens of Southwest Florida by WGCU Public Media. Show your appreciation for programs like these. Become a member of WGCU, a business supporter, or leave a legacy through a state or planned gift. Call or visit our website at wgcu.org.